Hello, I'm Hannah, and this is Hannah's Books. Welcome to the second evening of Hannah's Bookica. Last night, my family lit our Hanukkah, or menorah, for the first night of Hanukkah. Tonight will be the second lighting, when we'll light both the helper candle and two main candles. As you saw in my thumbnail, I've also made a Bookica for these videos, and I'm lighting it with tasseled bookmarks. I can't wait to see all 8 books illuminated at the end of the week. Oh, bookish fun. For today's video, I'm going to do another tag, one that Reiner at Rainier Books posted yesterday, the New York Times By the Book tag. It's actually an old tag, but he recognized how great it is and decided to bring it back to BookTube, now that there are so many new channels that have never participated, including both Reiner's channel and my own. Excellent plan. Interestingly, I was thinking of doing something similar at some point. I really love reading these interviews each week in the New York Times Book Review. Often the questions remind me of BookTube and our conversations here. The interviews are almost like tags themselves, about not just particular books, but about the way people experience their reading lives. A couple of weeks ago, Robert McFarlane was asked everything from which genres he usually avoids to how he arranges his books. Get this, the author of The Old Ways and Underland avoids nature writing. And he arranges his books by color. The reason that last answer really amused me is because he mentions afterwards that his partner is a scholar in Chinese studies, and the vast majority of those books are red. And then the next week, Claudia Rankin gives a really beautiful response when asked about her ideal reading experience. She says, "I love when someone enters the room when I'm reading. I see their lips moving, but I'm now in another country, perhaps even in another century. I am fighting both to stay where I am and to regain composure in the present day, hour, moment. It's a struggle within myself I can only locate with books I cannot leave behind." Well, today I'll answer the official tag questions, but I have a feeling that sometime soon I might make another video in response to this tag, perhaps choosing some of the additional questions I've been seeing in the By the Books column lately, ones that have especially intrigued me. So let's get started. The first question is, what book is on your nightstand now? I've got several books on the go right now, including one BookTube buddy read and one family buddy read, more about both soon, but I also have been reading a really charming book that I've been poking into right before bed and sometimes first thing in the morning, and that is Stig Abel's new book, Things I Learned on the 628, A Guide to Daily Reading. He was the editor of the Times Literary Supplement, sort of a competitor to the New York Times Book Review, which makes this kind of a funny answer, I suppose. Anyway, Things I Learned is really fantastic so far. It's a near-daily account of what Abel is reading and thinking about while he's on his train commute to work each morning, back in 2019 when such things happened. Although each month is shaped around a particular theme, the bookish chat ranges all over the place and is incredibly funny as well as smart. I'll be talking about this book more in the future, but I'll say for now that it's a perfect nightstand book. Question number 2. What was the last truly great book you've read? I was absolutely blown away by George Eliot's Middlemarch, which I read in October. Yes, I know, how can I not have read Middlemarch at some point in my first 5 decades as a reader? Anyway, I think I must spend at least an hour a day living in the world of Middlemarch still, ever since I put the book down. I can't imagine this book ever leaving me. Since I was a very young teenager, or perhaps a preteen, I felt that way about Jane Eyre, and I assumed that would only be possible for books that have meant a lot to us since our youth, books we grew up with. But Middlemarch feels just as formative to me now as Jane Eyre does, even though I know it can't exactly be true. Question 3. If you could meet any writer, dead or alive, who would it be? And what would you want to know? I gave several answers recently for the literary dinner party tag that sort of addresses this question, but I'll try to come up with someone else this time. I'd love to meet Emily Dickinson. I'd really love for her to see how she's acquired this whole varied mythology around her reclusive life. I care less about the truth of what her anger was, or her sexuality, or her religious life, than I do about how she would think about how her biographers and even pop culture has created her in ways that might surprise her a bit. Number 4, what books might we be surprised to find on your shelves? I know you wouldn't be surprised by my overly large collections of cookbooks and knitting books, but maybe you'd be surprised that I have several different books about Jews and circumcision. Don't ask. Question 5. How do you organize your personal library? Not very well. Some parts are organized now, although inconsistently. I split books up by the country of origin of the author, then arrange them by author, put in roughly chronological order, more or less. And when I know them off the cuff without looking it up, I even put individual authors' works in basic order of publication. But I'm not rigorous about it. In some sections of my personal library, I've interspersed novels with biographies of the author of those novels, or other nonfiction studies of those novels or authors. But then there are places where I keep all literary biographies separate from their subjects. Perhaps someday I'll work towards consistency, but probably not. My library is not so enormous that I can't figure out where a book is in just a couple of tries. The 6th question. What book have you always meant to read and haven't gotten around yet? Anything you feel embarrassed never to have read? There are so many. I'll name 4 things here, 2 of which I plan to get to in 2021, and 2 more that might be on tap for 2022. I've never read Proust, and I hope to read at least 1 volume this coming year. If I love it, perhaps I'll immediately continue reading through the series. Secondly, I've read very little Trollope, and I think this may be the year to finish the Barsetshire series. At some point, I need to sit down with Crime and Punishment. I love Dostoevsky's Brothers K, so I suspect I'll be taken in by C&P. And then finally, well, at least for this particular tag question response, I need to get to Tolstoy's War and Peace. Anna Karenina is a book I loved, but War and Peace terrifies me, mostly because of its length. I mentioned it recently in some video, maybe the anti-TBR tag, and a lot of you told me it was completely worth the commitment. I even knew that before, but there's nothing like peer pressure and elegant encouragement to get the book off the shelf. Question 7. Disappointing, overrated, just not good. What book did you feel you were supposed to like but didn't? Do you remember the last book you put down without finishing? I'm especially taken with that last part, the recent book you've put down without finishing. Since the pandemic really hit the East Coast in March, I've been almost completely unable to read fiction successfully. At first, I thought light fiction, cozy mysteries maybe, would see me through some difficult days. But I couldn't keep my mind on light and cozy. So I tried hard and rigorous. Well, I of course couldn't think my way through that kind of book either. Eventually, I turned to reading almost exclusively nonfiction, often about literary figures, but not always. This year, I did reread both Charlotte Bronte's Jane Eyre and William Faulkner's Sound and the Fury. But the only new-to-me novel I think I've finished since spring was Middlemarch. And because of a buddy read I was very excited about, and because both my son and husband love the book, I tried to pick up Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man sometime in the fall. For those of you who followed my channel for a long time, books by African-American authors of the 20th century are books in which I'm better read than I am in most other genres. But I'd never read Invisible Man. I don't fully understand it, but I was so racked with anxiety and tears after the first few chapters that I had to put it down for a while. I begged on my buddy reader, who was kind enough to be very understanding and to schedule the time when we'll read it together in the future. I did not put Ellison down because the book was disappointing or overrated. I did because I was not able to read it at that moment. And I know a time will come when I can appreciate it far more. The eighth question. What kind of stories are you drawn to? Any you stay clear of? I was talking with my husband David yesterday about the kinds of books he is especially drawn to, and realized as he was talking that I'm not sure I really have an answer for myself. In a separate conversation with him, we were joking about what to name my little corner of BookTube, and David at one point suggested gray. I quickly shot back that not all of us are gray, that many of the folks I love to watch are young folks who have not yet gone gray, and a couple of you are bald. He, of course, was not being so literal. Gray was because I hate folks who get too black or white about what they like and don't like, or too polarized about what's good and bad without thoughtful analysis or critique or even just personal context. I like it when discussion centers on what is not so certain, not so defined. I like the gray questions that hold so much conversations embedded in them. So yes, gray means maturity, but not necessarily the kind of maturity that's often paired with gray hair. And I suppose that what I like in BookTube channels, it's what I like in books as well. Thoughtfulness, openness to new kinds of understandings, and characters that are not all good or all bad, that are gray. Question 9. If you could require the president to read one book, what would it be? This is such a great question. I wish I had a great answer. I suppose it depends on who is president at any given time, of course. Obama's Dreams of My Father might have been a book I wanted Trump to read and really consider at the beginning of his term. I think the book's focus on the complexity of a distinctly American identity might make it a really meaningful book for presidents to read, since presidents need to understand that American identity is built for most Americans around experiences far different from what many presidents experienced in their own lives. And that is what great literature can do. It can broaden what we can see and imagine and accept. And finally, what do you plan to read next? I have too many books on my immediate list, but two that I really would love to read at the end of December are two books I should have read long before now. Francesca Wade's Square Haunting, which you may have noticed is part of my Bookakia or Book Menorah, and the other is The Gentleman in Moscow by Amor Towles, a book my husband loves and mentioned in his recent appearance on my channel. Okay, that's it. I want to tag a few people, five women whose channels I've been loving for a while. Courtney Ferreter, Kim at Middle of the Book March, Heidi at My Reading Life, Lindsay from Lindsay's Book Life, and Karen Evans. All five of these folks have fabulous channels that I suspect you already know, but if not, go check them out. Well, happy holidays, everyone. See you tomorrow for the third evening of Bookakia.